afternoon. I'd like to thank Mr. Balasubramaniam for his very eloquent introduction for organizing this thing. And I must say it has been a real pleasure for me to meet him today for the first time. My name is Sunil Mikhi, so I'm a professor of physics at IISER Pune. And I don't want to stand too long between you and the main talk of today, which is by Professor Seema, who is sitting here. But I'd like to say a few words about three things. One is about a theme that Bala just introduced already, which is what is basic science good for? Why should we do it? And some of the historical developments, which we don't always appreciate adequately. The second thing I'd like to talk about in my other capacity as chair of the endowment committee in IISER is our endowment activity in which we partner with industry. And the third thing I will talk about is Professor Seema Sharma. So I'll start if this, yeah. So I've called this brief talk Tomorrow's Science because of the logo of IISER Pune, which is where Tomorrow's Science begins today. And some of these pictures you see here are actually, so this one for example is from a lab at IISER, and today we won't have time to talk about it, but it's a Bose-Einstein condensate for those who are interested. I'd like to start by giving you a quote from a Nobel laureate who's visited IISER and who I'm fortunate to know personally very well. He said this to the press at the Indian Science Congress in Mysore a couple of years ago. I don't seem to be getting much action with this. Okay, maybe I have to stand here. I can stand here. So he said, new inventions, technologies, products that can compete on the world stage are in the end based on new discoveries, new understanding of the workings of nature, what we call basic science. And this is a very important theme. This is the foundation which leads to all the inventions, technologies and products which both make us money, they make our societies richer, and they make our lives also richer. And so he concluded this by saying, my suggestion is that you replace the slogan make in India with the slogan discover, invent and make in India. And I feel proud to say that out of these, particularly discover in India is something that we at IISER are doing very actively. Now, basic science is the foundation of so many major advances that have changed our lives just in the last 20 years. And I'll just run through a few of them. Computers, mobile phones, telecommunications, you can see them here. On the left are a number of technological advances without which we almost can't function. On the right side are many medical advances, and well, if you're young, maybe you didn't have any of these, but when you reach my age, you have to have all of these one after the other. So it's very good to know that they are much better, they are much more painless, they are much more successful than the things which used to come, which our parents and grandparents used to experience. And all of these have come out of science, basic science innovation. I'll spend just 2 minutes talking about lasers because it's one of the most interesting success stories of basic science. You might know that lasers, yeah, if we had a laser here, this would have worked better. You might know that lasers were invented by physicists fascinated by the properties, yeah, thank you, that's the right thing. Fascinated by the properties of atoms and light. And literally they were tinkering in their labs. And nowadays we talk about tinkering labs, but this is really stuff that happened by people just tinkering in their labs. But before that, there was a rather well-known person called Einstein, who after having invented or discovered special theory of relativity, general theory of relativity, started to speculate about the nature of light. And the idea which he had turned eventually into the concept of laser. But there was a 40-year gap between Einstein's idea and the first theory, not experiment, just the theory how to do it, how to make a laser. And it was not clear in this period of 40 years that it could ever be done. There are many ideas floating around right now. It's not clear if they can ever be done. The same status was held by laser from 1917 to 1958. But these people only wrote a paper, couple of papers, saying that, well, we think it can be done and it should be done in this way. And then Maiman, who you see over here, actually made the first prototype. Now, very interesting is that Sholo and Towns were working for Bell Telephone Laboratories and Maiman was working for the Hughes Aircraft Company. And neither of them had any idea that they are going to make something which is useful for telephones or for aircraft, and their companies knew that and they funded the research nonetheless. And commercial, even after 1960 till 74, it was a very exotic thing. So maybe some lab would have a huge laser, but of course after 1974, apparently the first major laser application in commercial daily life was the barcode scanner, then CD player, then laser printer, then of course this laser which I'm holding in my hand, and it became a very commonplace thing. And the interesting part is that if you ask today, what are the commercial or industrial applications of laser or laser to daily life of people, this is a partial list. You know, I use the smallest font available to fit maximum number of things on a page. The full list has about double of these things. And if you scan it, you realize that, well, you never thought about it. Okay? I mean, writing subtitles onto motion picture films, when you watch a motion picture, never occurred to you that laser would have done that. Laser guidance for aircraft, laser cutting, welding, drilling. This is actually all the mostly non-medical. Here are a few medical applications. It's that many things in one century. So actually, last year was the centenary of Einstein's paper on the laser. I don't even know if it was celebrated anywhere. Not. So you see, we take these things very much for granted. So let me move on. I'll just show you. This is the abstract of the paper of Sholo and Towns from Bell Telephones. And it is quite noteworthy. I read the whole paper recently. None of them, neither this nor the subsequent papers, discuss any possible application of this technique. Forget socially relevant applications. Saying that this will be beneficial for society was not in their mind. Even the idea that it will be beneficial for anything at all was not in their mind. Okay? They just wanted to understand light. And laser is the most concentrated form of light, this you know. And their papers were stimulated by pure curiosity, but importantly, funded by industry. And I think this is a point that I am happy to make over here. I keep making it, and I hope this is a message that will be taken seriously. Now, this is an accelerator. This is the inside of the tunnel of an accelerator. Seema works at an accelerator, and you will be hearing about these things in great detail. But let me just mention that these beasts, these accelerators, are very large, very expensive objects to study basic science, but just the spin-offs from these would alone justify their enormous expense, and it's something we don't always realize. So here is a short list of some therapies and basically medical treatments which have all come from particle accelerators. So Bala mentioned positron emission tomography. That's just one in a long list of things which simply wouldn't have been possible without elementary particle accelerators to study basic science. But the biggest spin-off, which also Bala mentioned, is the invention of the World Wide Web. And let me just take a few seconds to tell you what that is, because I think most people have not really realized what was the brilliant idea. It happened in 1990. Till that time, internet already existed, but consisted of sending emails from here to there. And emails were filling up people's disks, which didn't have much storage. And the idea that was pioneered at CERN by Sir Tim Berners-Lee, why not have, instead of sending information to people, why not keep the information in a place where people can see it anytime, otherwise known as a web page. And for the protocol for web pages, and many of you might know this because many of you must be Infotech people, but the protocol he used was called WWW for World Wide Web. And this was out of the demands of data storage at CERN at the accelerator around 1990. Seema will tell you about big data, which is the current kind of development due to current demands of data storage at CERN. So each of these demands leads to a new technological innovation. Okay. Now let me get on to IISER Pune, where I work. So this is the institute. It's not so far from here. In Pashan, and people are welcome to visit. IISER was founded just 12 years ago under the Ministry of HRD, and it's dedicated to front-ranking research in all areas of science, integrated with a strong educational program of an international standard. These are pictures from some of our physics labs. I'm in physics, so these were the pictures I got. We also have labs in biology, chemistry, and so on. So our research spans all these areas and also now humanities. And the work we do, our product, if you like, of which we are most proud, is our publications in leading journals and being part of the international community. So not only we study what people do abroad, people abroad or in India study what we do, and so we are a full part of the frontier research community in all areas of science. We also have, we are dedicated to education and research, and these are our flagship programs, a five-year a BS MS dual degree, a five-year PhD degree, a six-year integrated PhD dual degree. So two types of PhD. So this one, the five-year degree is after master's, this degree is directly after bachelor's all the way to PhD. So these are our flagship programs. We have a wonderful batch of students. I can't tell you how wonderful they are. It's the most inspiring thing in my entire career, though I worked 30 years almost in TIFR in Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Mumbai. But moving here, the goal was primarily to interact with undergraduate students, and they're just amazing. They're taught from a research perspective, and they're inducted into experimental and theoretical research with faculty guides at a young age. So by the time they go on to do PhD, which many of them do, they have already experienced research, and that gives them a huge head start. Okay, so sorry, the last part of the slide is gone, but they have been very successful in getting research positions in India and abroad at leading international institutions. Okay, since I told you we started only 12 years ago, here is a beautiful graph which suggests an institute which is growing. That's us, 44 faculty in 2000, faculty and student strength, sorry. So faculty is the light green and dark is the undergraduate students. So one faculty and 44 students, and today 123, and that's last year, and 852 students. By now it's actually something like 1,000 students. So this is our growth trajectory. Likewise, our research publications are growing, and these are our numbers from 2006 until 2017. I'll just, since there's not enough time to go into details, but maybe another time, or maybe if you visit IISER, this is some short list of the kind of subjects on which we do research. So on the left side, you see a number of biology subjects, and epigenetics you will hear about from Professor Galande, who will speak here in February. This side has a bunch of topics in chemistry, synthesis, design and synthesis of materials and so on. This is a list of topics in physics, and this is a list of topics in mathematics, and these are just a short list of all the different topics on which we do research. We have outreach activities, and Professor Shashidhara sitting in the front row is the person who has really spearheaded these things. So we try to reach out to society through our outreach, and we have a bunch of, you see these programs, some are for school kids in Pune, some are for underprivileged students, some are for, like the science quiz is just for college kids all over the country. This is the leading science competition in India today, and here are some pictures which show you. And in fact, today's activity is sponsored by this thing with a very long acronym, of which are more detailed. Now let me talk about the endowment. So I still have 1 minute, and in this minute I will talk about endowment as well as about the speaker. So our research achievements are already making a global impact. We are training a large manpower base, and okay. The problem though is that global competition is enormous. We are a government institute, we have government funds under government rules. I think the government has been quite generous in setting it up, but there is a stage when to grow rapidly, we need input of funds and support and partnership. And our PTO for investments, Shubhangi, is sitting over here. She's here and has interacted with some of you, and she can provide more information about our endowment effort. Let me just tell you that IISER has been fortunate to get endowments from these companies, which you'll recognize all the names. And these are quite large. These are the large endowments that we have, which are mainly for buildings. And some of these are like support for students and so on. And we have a very professional time frame for construction. So here is a building. Already this is old. The building is almost finished by now. Here is a women's hostel that's coming up. That's also partly, almost nearing completion. So there are two types of contributions or support that can be given to our endowment effort, either to fund basic science projects or social relevant, socially relevant projects or the educational program. That's one type, and the other type has more like specific targeted grants, which are for things like chairs, for infrastructure, for visitors, for students' travel and so on. Now I'd like to go on to today's speaker, Professor Seema Sharma. She's an associate professor at IISER Pune. She's been with us for four and a half years. She's one of our most outstanding faculty members, and I'll just like to tell you a few things about her. She comes from Rajasthan, and she got her PhD in 2008 at TIFR in Mumbai. I was a faculty member there at that time, and I had the privilege, I would say, of teaching her. I taught a course at which she was a student. And for her entire career, she has worked on a single detector, the compact muon solenoid, or CMS, at CERN in Geneva, and she'll tell you more about this. Now, you might think a single detector looks like that, but that's not what it looks like. The CMS is a gigantic detector of elementary particles, and she will tell you more details. She has participated in both ideas and in contribution to parts, specific parts of this detector. So now this detector is one of two that found the now celebrated Higgs particle. You must have read about this in 2012. And Seema herself was one of the authors of the publication that announced this discovery, because she's a member of the CMS team, the CMS collaboration. At that time, she was a postdoctoral fellow in Illinois at the Fermi National Laboratory, and we were very lucky to get her to take up a faculty position at IISER Pune in 2014. Just a couple more words and then she can start. So in this enormous collaboration of 4,000 plus scientists from all over the world, it's easy to just get lost and be a small part of it. Seema is not a small part of it. She's a major part of this collaboration. And for 2 years, she was given this post of convener of what is called the JETMET Physics Object Group of the collaboration, which is like a group tasked with doing a certain part of the analysis of the data coming out of the detector. This year, she was honored with a different convenership. So when this ended, she's now the convener of the Supersymmetry Physics Group. And in these capacities, she communicates directly with the senior-most management of this large enterprise costing billions of dollars and sitting in Geneva and funded by multiple nations, including, I should say, India. We are now associate members as a country. So to close, I'll just show you one more slide. She recently got an award as LPC Distinguished Researcher, and this sort of cements her standing in the field as one of the most well-known elementary particle physicists, not just in India, but in the world. So I present Seema Sharma, and I look for, like you, I look forward to her talk. Please. The slide changes.
Okay. Hello, everyone. First of all, many thanks to Bala and Shashi for organizing this event. And it's a fantastic opportunity for me also. And thanks, Sunil, for the nice introduction to IISER and also about me. But I must admit that after my talk, you will realize that all of us collectively, we hardly know anything. That I will convince you. So the talk today is about the big data to fundamental constituents of universe, and also chasing new physics at LHC, whether it's Higgs, dark matter, and whatever else that can come up. So why particle physics, or why we are worried about the research in particle physics? That's the bigger question, or in a nutshell. So first of all, I would like to admit that this talk might have a lot of information, and that's the intentionally done so that you get a gist of what exactly it is all about, instead of going into the details of a small speck of it. But I will be more than happy to come back and talk about a particular topic if there is an interest and go in more details of it. So all of us have wondered, what are the fundamental constituents of universe? Basically, what is the smallest entity which is indestructible, which makes us? Okay, no, I thought there was some question. Oh, okay, sorry. Thanks for that though. And how do these constituents talk to each other? So how do they interact and make whatever we are or what the structures around us are? So this is the universe around us. And I know it's a busy picture, So let's start with this one, the visible universe, that's of the order of billion, billion, billion meters. Usually talk about in these distances or these scales, we talk in terms of the light years. That is the distance traveled by a light in a year. Okay, that's of the order of 10 to the power of 16 meters. And if I really talk in that, it's 100 light years. But a small speck here is something what the galaxy clusters are. And out of these galaxy clusters, we have somewhere our Milky Way, and also popularly known as Akashganga. And this itself something like 1,000 billion, billion meters. And then somewhere in the galaxy, we have our solar system, which is already 150 billion kilometers. And the Earth, all of us know about this span, it's something like 13,000 kilometers. And this patch here shows a 1 kilometer circle of a sand, of a footprint, which is of the order of like just a few centimeters. And out of this, if I pick up a sand grain, that's the minimum which I can go with a naked eye and I can see. Okay, and that's of the order of like half millimeter. I mean, have you wondered like how much my ruler can go, a 1 centimeter, and we have millimeters divided into 10 pieces. And how smaller can you go with your naked eye? Okay, and then it's made up of, okay, fine, we have some molecules here. I just picked up one silicon oxide molecule, which is of the order of 1 nanometer size in the spanning. But then we realize, okay, inside structure is there, and 1 oxygen nucleus can be of the order of femtometer. The point which I would like to make here is that our eyes are very, very limited in what we can see. And this is more clear from this slide. If the things are way too big, like galaxies or beyond that, we need special tools for that also. If the things are way too small, like beyond like a fraction of millimeter, then also we need special tools. So what we see with our naked eyes are extremely small picture of the universe around. Okay, so today's talk, we will focus more on a smaller side of it. For the larger side, I think it should come for the next talk by Professor Shomak Roy Chaudhary for the cosmological scales. And that's very, very interesting stuff. This, what is interesting here that I will talk about today. Okay, so let's move ahead. So where did it all come from? We talk about the universe, we talk about these big structures, we talk about these small structures. Then what is this all about? Our modern understanding, I think in schools many of us have read, in fact most of us must have read about the Hubble and the expansion of the universe and galaxies are moving from each other and we have some ways to figure it out. Okay? So the current picture or current understanding is that something happened at the Big Bang. There was some hot ball which exploded and matter was spewed out. Okay, but when was it? Our best understanding today, and it is more or less precise, is that we are already, the universe is already 13 billion years old. So we are somewhat here, where we have us, we have accelerators, we have many other things, we have understanding of the gravity, the gravitational waves have already been discovered. But what happened exactly when we go close to this Big Bang? How the inflation started, what was there, how did we arrive at? Okay, those are the questions we are trying to understand in our research work. Okay, so let's move ahead. So what I'm doing here at LHC, or Large Hadron Collider, which I will explain later, we are going somewhat very, very close to the Big Bang, and that also not like really here at the like when it was started. We are still at the level of like 10 to the minus 10, 10 to the minus 12 seconds, not beyond that. So we are studying these regions at the Large Hadron Collider. Okay, so how do we go about it? So our quest is for the fundamental particles or the fundamental constituents. What is the minimum possible? And this has been an ever-going quest. It's not that just we just started. Mendeleev in 1969 already had his periodic table. And he could really establish the fact that the atoms are the smallest piece of a substance that will retain its chemical identity. You take oxygen from anywhere, it's oxygen. You take silicon from anywhere, it's silicon. Okay? Whatever the billions of atoms we are inhaling every moment, that's all oxygen atoms, all same oxygen atoms. Okay, there are details, there might be isotopes, but let's not go into that detail at the moment. Okay, and the interesting thing here was that he could also predict some of the missing items there. So he studied, he saw some periodicity, he saw some structure there, and the question then was, okay, fine, what is going on? right? Science is not just about, okay, observing something. We also want to predict something. We also want to understand what is the next step to it, okay? So it came out that the atoms were not elementary, and that came out when J.J. Thomson was studying the cathode ray tubes. And cathode ray tubes are like known to all of us, either because of high school textbooks or because we had television sets like that, the big ones, at least I had seen in my house in my childhood, okay, not the LED ones which we have now. So the electrons was discovered in one of these studies when he saw that a stream of particles was coming out, and he applied the electric fields other way around, and he could see these bend, and from that he could figure out what is the charge of these particles. Okay, and that's how it was named the electrons, and it came out that it was 2000 times lighter than the hydrogen atom itself. By the way, the detail here is that he could measure only that's a negatively charged particle. He could not measure the charge or the mass. He could measure only E by M, the charge to mass ratio at that time. But more details came out in the further studies, and this was back already in like 1894 to 97. But this was not the end of the story. By 1900, the early 1900, the radioactivity was already discovered. Actually, by 1900, Henry Becquerel got a Nobel Prize for that. It was already established in 1996. And radioactivity is something like there is some disruption of the nucleus without any external energy provided. It's just spontaneous. Okay? So he was trying to study the radioactivity part, but then he realized that, okay, we already established these alpha particles which are coming out of some radioactive source. Alpha particles are nothing but two protons and two neutrons bound together, but they are charged particles. Okay, and from atom it was clear that if electrons are negative, there has to be some positive charge to balance it out. So it was a nice probe because these were positively charged particles, so it was expected to be deflected from the center if it is there. Okay, so what he did was he took this radioactive source which was emitting alpha particles, and he used a gold foil and studied with a detector. A detector can be a simple eye. An eye is the simplest example of a detector. We detect optical photons. That's why you and I are seeing each other. Okay, but then detectors come with their own capabilities. My eyes cannot see the infrared rays or the ultraviolet rays, but they do exist. We can't see X-rays, but that's our daily requirement. Okay, so that's how he came up, and he studied on a fluorescent screen that what is going on, and realized that there is some sort of a nucleus for an atom. So the full positive charge is concentrated really at a small scale in an atom. While the atom was 10 to the minus 10 meters, what we call angstrom, the nucleus was only 10 to the minus 5, 10 to the minus 15 meters. Okay, so it was 100,000 less volume that it was occupying, this radius it was occupying. And that's how the nucleus was established, or the atomic structure was established, but not the atomic structure from the full quantum theory yet. These developments were all going in parallel. What I'm telling you is a very, very simplified story in two slides. It took more than 30 years to establish the whole thing. But the question is, why did Rutherford need to use alpha particles to discover the nucleus of the atom? And we know from the optics that if you want to study a smaller scale, your wavelength of the light you are using has to be smaller than that size or equivalent to that size. It's simple, like when you use a ruler, if you have a centimeter in a ruler and you want to measure millimeters, you cannot be very precise. It's a very, very simple analogy, but that's exactly what is happening. We need a wavelength which can probe this structure. Okay, and that's exactly, but then these were the particles. What we are talking about, the light. So dual matter of the nature of the particles and the light is what came to save us for our further advancement of our understanding of the nature. Okay, so light is known to be a wave, and that we know from the diffraction experiments back in the 18th century itself. But the particle nature was established in the photoelectric effect when light was shown on a metal and some particles came out, basically electrons came out. And then Einstein came up with a explanation, okay, fine, this is the what is happening, the corpuscular or the particle nature of the light. But then de Broglie went ahead and he was more daring and said that, okay, the matter also exhibit the wave particle nature. There's a duality. And we are all talking about the atomic scales here. You're not talking about the hour or your mind scale at this moment. The basic nature still remains the same, but we won't observe it in the classical scale. Okay? So subatomic matter also exhibits both particle and wave nature. And the relation is that the higher the energy of the particle, the smaller is the wavelength. Okay, so the alpha particles which Rutherford used was traveling with of the order of 5% of the speed of light, and that exactly give him the wavelength of the order of 10 to the power minus 13 centimeter, which is essentially smaller than the atomic size. Atomic size is much less than, much larger than this one in compare. It's 10 to about 10 meters, 10 to the minus 10 meters, sorry. Okay, so that's the reason he could really use the alpha particles to go further inside the nucleus. If the alpha particles were not that much energy, probably he wouldn't have. Because then you see atom as a whole, you don't probe inside it. Okay, so this is basically a starting point where the particle physics actually started with. This was the particle physics of that era. So probing the smallest distances, we need different instruments. Optical microscopes, they can go up to 10 to the minus 4 centimeter. Electron microscopes, they can further go to the atomic level. Then the radioactive sources, which can really study of the order of nucleus. And then we have the accelerators, where we want to go further inside the nucleus, protons and neutrons. Okay? So the matter around us, essentially what makes you and me, are essentially we have the atom, which is made up of an electron and the nucleus. The nucleus is known to be a proton and neutron, and we already know that the proton and neutron are essentially made up of the quarks. So as the energies were increased, as we had high energy probes, we can go further inside these structures and study what is going on inside them. So the quarks are established quite a while ago now. Okay, so if you really see what makes us is essentially quarks, which are two types of quarks here, and which is the nucleus, then we have the electrons, and there were neutrinos which were inferred from the radioactivity studies, right? In the radioactivity study, we saw electrons, but the electron spectrum did not match with what we would expect, and then it came out something going on which is taking away the energy, and those came out to be the neutrinos. This led to also the discovery of the antimatter, and I said that all these things were going on in parallel. Dirac was trying to make sense of the electron, the motion of equation for the electrons, which also has another property called spin, spin half particles. And to make the sense of solutions of that equation, he says there's something, a sort of partner of electron has to exist, who's exactly same except the charge. It's a positively charged counterpart of the electron. Okay, and this was actually sort of observed in an experiment. In a magnetic field, the positive and negative charge will go other way around, and that's exactly what was observed. The electron go this way, positron go this way, and this is what observed in one of these old experiments which were using some photographic plates. And antimatter is not a science fiction anymore. We use them all the cancer treatments on the daily basis. That's what you call the PET or positron emission spectrum. So what we finally end up with is, to summarize, the fundamental forces of the nature, the gravitational force which is keeping all the galaxies together, these are the big structures. Then the electromagnetic force which keeps the atom intact is the forces between the electric charges. Then there is the strong force which keeps the atomic nucleus intact. And we realize that why do we need this one? What was the reason that people had to worry about it? The reason is that you have so much of positive charge in a very small scale. Right? So you need to have something more stronger than which can keep the mind together. Otherwise they will just fly apart. And the strong force comes out to be same for the neutrons or the protons. It doesn't care for the electric charge. That's how the nucleus was intact. And then there is a weak force which is responsible for radioactivity. So without any supplying any external energy or any external stimulation, I can have the nuclear disintegrate. And an electron and neutrino come out. And this is exactly the force which is also responsible that why we are getting light from the sun. And a lot of neutrinos also bombarding us all the time, but they don't interact. And how these forces are manifested, how they talk to each other, these elementary particles talk to each other. And that's where the quantum mechanics and the quantum field theory comes in picture. So the particles are treated as the fields, and they exchange with each other the force carriers. And that is our best understanding so far. And this comes out to be correct. We can do all the calculations and find out what will be the rate of such reactions, how much energy will be carried by electrons, how much carried by photons. And this is the picture for the electromagnetic force. The electrons is scattered, and it is by exchange of a photon. And strong force is being carried by exchange by the gluons. Okay? And what happens to the weak interactions then? why they are weak. The rate is extremely small. And it comes out, the particle which is exchanged is very, very heavy as compared to the photons and gluons, which are massless. Since it's heavy, it becomes difficult to create it, and it becomes it too difficult to travel, and that's why this rate is weak. By the way, there is a very, very delicate balance in nature of all this, the strengths of these forces. If the weak interaction was much more powerful, the sun would be burned out by now. If the strong force was not as strong, we would be flying apart, we would not exist. So there is a very, very fine balance among all these forces. Of course, we don't know why it is so, that's the way it is. So how do we produce such particles if we want to study them, or we want to establish their reality, that they do exist? Okay, and there comes the E equals MC square, which most of us are familiar with. I think I'm sure many of you have t-shirts with the Einstein's photograph and the E equals MC square. And that's the energy mass equivalence, saying that if I have a huge energy, I can convert to the masses. And that's exactly what we are doing at the LHC. So at Large Hadron Collider, we accelerate the protons to 7 TeV. Now, TeV, please excuse me for this unit, but this is exactly the units we are using at the atomic scale. So you can think it of as the terms of the electron mass is half MeV, half milli electron volt. Okay, and 1 electron volt is the energy gained by electron traversing through the 1 voltage difference. Right? So, and we are colliding these we accelerate the protons and collide them, and that's where we create a lot of energy concentrated in a very, very small volume. And that's where we are creating the, we are really sort of talking to the vacuum fluctuations here and creating the new particles. So this is what happening. After we establish that there are up and down quarks which are making us, then there is an electron and neutrino, and we had access to these accelerators, we could create more new particles and study them further. So the first came the other quarks. And the muons, they are exact counterparts of the electrons, but they are heavier. And we got these from cosmic rays. Actually, the muons first came up from the cosmic rays when people were studying the cosmic showers, and it came out, okay, fine, there is something more going on in the atomic scale, in the fundamental particles. And that's how, piece by piece, these stories were built up. So we have three generations of the quarks and three generations of the electrons. We call them leptons. So the purple ones here are the three generations of the quarks, the up-down, charm-strange, top-bottom. Top was discovered in 1995, and it was in Fermi lab. The W and Z were discovered earlier because they are lighter than the top. So the energies which were needed to access them or produce them, which were smaller. And those were already established in 83, 84. So, and these are the force carriers, the photons for the electromagnetic interactions, gluons for the strong interaction, and these two for the weak interactions. And then we can write down their equations of motion, how they talk to each other. We can actually find out all the rates that if I have this particle, how they will react, and what exactly will come out of it. We do all these calculations, and all the simulations are available that we use on our daily basis. So these are sort of what I just call traffic rules, but you can write the Lagrangian, that's what you call the equations of motions. And this is what was there when I started my master's, actually, and even my PhD, except this term. This was only on the papers. So these equations I really solved during my master's exams. And seeing these equations materializing into the actual particle, which was the Higgs boson, it was once in a lifetime experience. I was at CERN that time. So how do, the question remaining here was that how do these particles acquire masses? Because their masses are different. Other than that, the generations are identical. They will behave in similar way. Okay? So it comes out that the Higgs field theoretically was essentially suggested by Peter Higgs and his collaborators independently. And actually, all these concepts came from the condensed matter. People were trying to do something very, very different. And they were applied to the particle physics. Theoretically, it just said that there is one more field. And when I quantize, I get more particle. That's what we call the Higgs particle. The phi term here is nothing but the Higgs field. So how does the Higgs field work? How does it give particles the masses? If there are no masses, I said this, all these particles are identical. Their interactions are identical. So how do the Higgs behave? So in a very simplistic way, if there is nothing in the universe, then electron is electron, photon is photon, top quark is top quark. They come out to be the way they are. But there is a background Higgs field in the universe, and when the particles are traversing through, it acts like sort of a fluid, you can say. So the heavier the particle, the slower down is motion in fluid is. Other way to say, they acquire the mass. That is the basic simple idea in a simple way. So depending upon how strongly the particles interact with the Higgs field, the particles are massive or very light. The electron is very light, the top is very heavy. The Ws are heavy. So if you want to study Higgs boson, you have to look for the heavy particles because they interact much strongly with it. By the way, I did not mention it that all these particles which are heavy, they immediately decay. Their lifetimes are something like 10 to the power minus 25 seconds. So even if you produce them, it's not that I'm going to hold them. They just decay, and from their relics, whatever is remnant coming out, which are mostly the electrons, photons, muons, from that what we study in our detectors, which will I come to the next. Okay? And searching for the Higgs boson was one of the design goals of the LHC and one of the motivations even for me to go into high energy physics, because it was the exciting times. So now coming to the Large Hadron Collider, so we know that starting with that atoms have a very, very small structure. There are many fundamental particles. We know that we need highly energetic probes to study the smallest scales, and we know the energy equivalence, energy and mass equivalence. Okay? And that's exactly the concepts which are being used at the Large Hadron Collider. So what we do, this is an accelerator which is spanning 27 kilometers across the borders of Switzerland and France. It's just two steps and you are either in Switzerland or in France. It used to be fun when I first went there. Okay, no, it's in Schenigen, so it doesn't matter. You can walk around anywhere. And there are two general purpose detectors. One is called Atlas, other is called CMS. These are huge detectors. I work with the CMS, but they are more or less to cross each other if there are discoveries. So when Higgs particle was discovered, it was actually observed by both of them. So how do the accelerators work? It's again same our school level physics, that we know the acceleration of the charged particle as it passes through the potential difference or the electric field. The force is just charge multiplied by the electric field. Okay, and the RF, the radio frequency cavities, we are using at accelerator, the LHC, that's of the order of like 5 megavolt per meter. That's the accelerating voltage. That's the power we have. But then we have to keep these particles in a circular trajectory, because my collider here is circular. So there we make use of the magnetic field, which just changes the direction of the particles as it is traversing the magnetic field. I'm sure since most of you are in the technology side, you have done all these problems in the various exams and the entrances. Okay? The key point here is the scale of it, is the sheer scale of it. I said it's 27 kilometers in the ring. And it is 100 meters underground. That saves a lot of money as well as the radiation, the backgrounds. Okay? So the actual parameters of LHC are that the dipole magnets which are operating in this ring across, they are maintained at 1.9 Kelvin. That is really close to the absolute zero. And we are the biggest consumer of the liquid helium right now. In fact, we have complaints from our condensed matter colleagues. We need 120 tons of helium for this project to get it running, because these are all superconducting magnets. If you don't maintain them at the high, low temperature, they will just melt away. And we had this accident in 2008 when LHC was supposed to start. We started the beam, boom, there was an explosion and it got stalled for 1 year. The things were to be repaired, then only we can start again in the end of 2009. So when I started my formula postdoc, really excited that, okay, fine, now there is a data, it was just gone for 1 year. Then, so in total number of magnets are something like 10,000 magnets. They can be of the order of few meters long. These are the proton bunches which are colliding. And each of the bunch can have 10 to the power of 11 protons. And the number of collisions per second is something like 1 billion. We are colliding at 40 megahertz. Every 25 nanoseconds, there is a proton-proton booming into each other. And that's what exactly is happening. So we have two proton beams going in opposite direction. At several points in the ring, we make them collide, just go on head on each other. And there is one particle where will be interaction will happening. And this is sort of creating what I said in the beginning, that at the time of the Big Bang, what happened? We are trying to create those kind of conditions here. Now, 1 TeV is not a big energy in our daily terms, but focusing it in a scale of 10 to the minus 15 meters is what is causing this part. And there is a lot of particles which are coming out, and our hope is that we will get hint to some of the things which was happening at the time of the Big Bang, or more fundamental particles being produced. And we have to collect all these particles, to see all these particles before they fly apart or decay. And for that, we have the CMS detector and the ATLAS detector. And again, they share a scale of it. So this is the CMS detector. I have just put a picture which is sort of split. And here is where the beam pipe is, so where the collisions will happen. Then we have a silicon based tracker, which is of the order of like some 100 million channels. And then we have the calorimeters, which really took care of the electrons, photons, and other particles. And then we have the particles which can be muons. And the total weight of this detector is 12,000 tons. And a lot of it coming from the calorimeter part. So this gray thing which you see, the blue one and the gray one which you see here. And also the stainless steel which goes in these red ones. The total diameter is 15 meters and overall length is like 20 meters. And we are using 4 Tesla magnetic field, because we want to differentiate between electron and positron. So you need to have magnetic field, so they go other way and we know what is going on. Okay. So this is how the particles go in this detector. So what I did, I am taking a slice, transverse slice from this particle. So this is where the interaction happened. This is where our Big Bang happened. And then we see all the different particles showing their signatures in different pieces of the detector. So we go back and try to see what happened in the collision. So you can see here, the photon is here, the electron is stopping here. But then we have hadrons which are coming here, protons or neutrons or pions, and the muons which is passing through. But all these particles, Higgs, W, Z, top, we using these signatures, we try to sort of infer what happened at the time of the collision. Bala, how I am doing on time? It's okay. Okay, thank you. So I said that heavier particles decay, but all of them have their own signatures. For example, Z boson decay, it decays into the two muons, and I see the two muons here. This is sort of an event display of that particular interaction which happened, which is of my interest. So I look for the collisions in which I see nothing but two muons coming out. Similarly, for example, this was one of the recent announcements from the CERN. Okay, we have a Higgs boson produced, but then with a TT bar. Now, here a lot of particles which are heavy. So you really need a very energetic collision which comes with a very, very small probability. And that's why it made a big deal when it was observed. Okay, so we have two top quarks and one Higgs boson. The Higgs boson is going to the two top particles, tau leptons, and then we have the top which is showing up as the B quarks. Okay, so you can see here how this picture looks like. We have the two B jets, one B jet, two B jets, the muons, the electron, and the top particle. So what we do is that we have these billions of collisions being selected, and we try to identify a small handful of events where we see the signatures of our interest. And that's a sort of Herculean task. And technical challenges, I'll just come to it. That we are colliding, I said, at 40 megahertz. And each of the event, there are something like 100 million individual electronics channels. So my each collision, if I really sort of try to read it out, it gives me of the order of 1 to 2 megabyte. Okay? So if I go with the 40 megahertz rate of collision, every 40 megahertz, if I like 1 billion collisions approximately, and I'm getting the 1 megabyte, then I generate 60 terabytes per second. There is no way that we can right now even think about storing it, even to the best of our technologies. So what do we do? It comes out that most of the collisions which are happening are really the mundane physics which we are all established. We are not interested in that one that much. What we are interested in, so this is the cross section. You can think of as a probability of something new happening or some process happening. Okay, so this is the part which is the proton-proton collisions. What is the probability of that happening if I pass the two bunches? And if I have a Higgs produced or a new physics produced, then it will lie somewhere here. So basically, producing a Higgs boson or a new physics particle is 1 in 1 billion. So what do? We cannot save all of these. There is no going back. Once you lose the event, once you lose the collision information, it's gone forever. So you have to be careful here, and that's what we call the trigger system. So what does trigger system do? It just tried to reduce this rate, which should be written to tape forever or for permanent storage or for further analysis. Okay? So what we do? We start at the 40 megahertz, that's where the collisions are happening. We have something called trigger system, which is essentially reading out from the detector, quickly processing the data, what has happened in the detector, look for the patterns of the energy deposits in the detector. This is a like two-tier system, and you can see it's a very complicated structure. And there is sort of a hold information, like some possibility that I can hold the information for a few microseconds. And within 3 microseconds, it tells me this event might be of interest or not. That's what we call the level one triggering. Okay, and that already reduces to 100 kilohertz. But even 100 kilohertz, we cannot write it right now at the tape. So we have to further reduce it. And for that, we have the high level triggering, which essentially is a, it can, we can wait for 1 second, we have that much of infrastructure. And this is more of a big software farm, where we are constantly running in real time. We see if the event is interesting, we save. So right now the rate is of the order of 500 hertz. So we are saving something like 500 collisions, the information from 500 collisions per second, out of the 1 billion we are creating. Okay, so there is a big chance here. If we lose the information, we lose the discovery, we lose all the taxpayers' money and all the efforts which go in. Okay, so this is extremely important. And so at the moment, even after all this, we are having something like 50 to 60 petabyte of data on tape every year with CMS and Atlas. And I'm not including here the non-LHC experiments. CERN has many experiments. It has some 20, 30 projects going on. So the next question is that, okay, fine, I'm saving this much of the data. But in every institute, for every analyzer, out of what 4,000 people Sunil mentioned, nobody will have like able to store all this data. So how do we share this data? So he talked about the WWW, right? Now we talk about the grid, the worldwide LHC grid. And that's how we share our information. Okay? So CERN is what we call, it's a tiered structure. CERN is what they call tier zero. And it's in the, located in Geneva only. So it does all the storing the raw data, and sort of serves for like 15 to 20% of the total computing facilities which are provided. Then we have tier one, where we have the permanent storage of the data and also copies of the data. You don't want to lose the data just because some site went or some sort of flood happened or something wrong happened or some accidentally, some glitch happened. I mean, human glitches can happen always. So we also have some copies of the data in a way that it's not duplicated sort of unrealistically, but at the same time safe enough. And then we have the tier twos. So this is the tiered structure, and tier twos are like across, we are also generating a lot of simulation actually, and the tier twos actually provide us the resources for the simulation and also end user analysis like me. When I am looking into the data, that's how I do it. And the concept is simple. We are switching the plug. We don't know where the electricity is coming from, which grid it is coming from. Same thing for me also. I ask for what data I want. I just give a tag for data and I have it on my screen. I don't care which site it is going to. This is all I sort of like, as an end user, all I care for is the data part. And this is very, very nicely structured and organized. It's really an international collaboration to distribute and analyze the LHC data. And it really integrates all the computing centers and the computing resources across the world. Okay? In India, TIFR is a tier two. And it is directly linked to the LHC 1 network via the 2.5 Gbps. Actually, this one actually came up when I was still a PhD student there sometimes in 2004. And the joke was like 2.5 Gbps. It's something like the scale was one movie download per second. I mean, then we were students then. And it also provides a lot of help to us analyzers in India. There are something like 80 of us. So now coming to the actual physics part of it. I said that Higgs can be produced at a very small rate and it decays immediately. And this is what exactly will be visible to me. I won't be able to hold on the Higgs directly. Same thing, or it can be in a different mode. It can go to Z. Now, the rate for Z is much larger than the gamma. Remember that these are the massive, and the massive Higgs likes to drop to the massive particles. So the idea is that only 0.2% will decay into photons, 1% will decay into the Z, and rest 99% is very, very hard to observe. So when the discovery came up, it actually came up in these two channels. This one because it was very clean, this one because it's accessible and again clean. So out of these billions of collisions, and we're trying to find out handful of events. So I will tell you what I mean by handful of events. So this is the picture from the discovery of the Higgs boson, and the standard model particle family was completed. It was predicted back in like 60s or 70s, it was established, but it was discovered only in 2012. And I was at CERN that time, and it was really sort of an exciting time there. And how to read this picture is essentially the colored one are what we know from our simulation or already known physics, the standard model. Okay, these are the collisions which look similar if I try to select the collisions. So some of the standard model collision will sweep in. Okay, so what you see here that this peak, the red one, cannot be explained by anything. It exists in data, we observed in data, but cannot be explained by the existing or already known physics. And you see the scale, here I am talking about something like the scale. When we see events 3 GeV, we are talking about number of collisions that we are selecting. Okay, and this is how the Higgs was established. Now the important here is that this is the first ever scalar, fundamental scalar observed in nature then. And it also sort of indicates the standard model, it's a very, very successful theory. However, it still doesn't explain everything. I cheated here, I did not tell that, okay, fine, gravity cannot be explained by standard model yet. There is no quantum theory for gravity yet, although we have observed the gravitational waves. So now coming to seeing the invisible, so I said that the 99% of the Higgs boson decays are very difficult to be observed. But as we are getting more and more data, we can effort to make tighter and tighter requirements on our collisions, that what kind of collisions I want. Plus, there is a lot of development which has happened in the machine learning the world. Also, the Google has made many of their algorithms available publicly now. Okay, so we make use of these advanced machine learning techniques. Like for example, in this case, I am showing these three cones. These are signatures for the quarks. Let me put it in a simple way. Okay, and here you can see there is sort of a detail here in the big quark jet or big quark signature versus the light ones. So if I just select like that, the information in the detector, I won't be able to make it out. But now I can go into details. We have a lot of data available. So I can figure out, I can use these techniques and apply. And we also sort of collaborate with the industry here as the more things are coming up. The machine learning and deep learning is really catching up in the particle physics for that matter, also in the neutrino physics. So what we have here is the Higgs 2 boson BB bar decay. And you can see here that how it will look like if I look at, so I see an axis here and we can start seeing the Higgs 2 BB bar coming out, which was not possible if it was small data or if I don't have these. We will have to wait for the more data, at least 2 years of more data. Okay, so the Higgs is more or less established. Although the Higgs is established, the standard model is a good theory, but it comes out that in the standard model theory, the Higgs mass is not stable. I'm talking about the theoretical concept here. Experimentally, I have observed the Higgs mass, which is of the order of 125 GeV. Okay, but theoretically, it cannot be established that way. When you start, when you invoke the quantum corrections to the Higgs boson mass, it becomes sort of infinite. And one of the reasons is that we don't have anything between the Planck scale where the gravity becomes important for these small particles versus now. Okay, so one of the suggestions is that maybe there is supersymmetry, that for every spin half particle, I have a spin one particle, spin zero particle, or every spin one particle, I have a spin half particle. Is one of the symmetries which is invoked, and this is one of the solutions. There are many of them. There are extra dimensions to look for, and then we have other things to explain, like for example neutrino masses, which we don't provide a solution in the standard model. So here the idea is that I am looking for particularly my research interest right now in this kind of scenarios. So I know gluons exist, I know Higgs exist, I am trying to look for their supersymmetric partner, and these are heavy particles. So their production is much more rarer than the one Higgs boson or the top quark. And SUSY also provide these particles here, they provide a viable solution for the dark matter. And that's one of my further interest in the supersymmetry. Because dark matter is an established problem, it's an established observation. And that is from the astrophysics and the cosmology. If you look at the rotational curves of the galaxies, I would expect the velocities to go down as we are moving away from the center of galaxy, but they just remain flat. And we call it dark matter because it is not luminous. If it was shining, we know it's a star or something, something. But it's through the gravitational effect. We are trying to see, okay, fine, it's a dark matter, something exists, but is it a fundamental particle or is something else going on? It's a different dynamics altogether. So one of the solutions, probably it can be that there is a supersymmetry and probably we will get a solution to it. Okay? So this is what we are trying to do. For example, this is one of the studies which my student has done from sitting in IISER only. And here we are trying to see if we can produce the super partners of the gluons. So they are strongly interacting particles, but with spin half, while the gluon is spin 1. All our force carriers are spin 1, they are bosons. Okay? And this is fermion. And then it decays to two bottom quarks and perhaps this candidate, which can be dark matter candidate. Okay, again you see here number of events, hardly 30 events after the billions we are colliding. Billions every second we are colliding, billions of Big Bangs we are creating. After we are selecting a billion probably in half a year, and out of those billion which we saved on the tape, I am looking for only 30 events. And they still comes out consistent with the standard model. If there was a new physics, I would have seen this blue curve. So my data would have been high. But so far, nothing. So a standard model is still valid even in this range. That's what makes it interesting actually, because every time you have new data, you want to look into it. Okay? There can also be direct production of the dark matter. There is also a possibility. And this is a different sort of a search which is going on. So we have these billions of events and we have like sort of a small chunk of data, usually non-overlapping, and try to see the different aspects of the different theories and the different physics. And here again, you see the data is completely matching with what you expect from the standard model, while the new physics dark matter would have shown these curves. That's how to read these curves. And again, the number of events here at the most 10,000 in this one. On the higher side, it's less than like 100 events, 100 collisions. That's what our selection procedure is. And that's where the machine learning tools are becoming really, really important here now. So that's where we are catching up. So without going into details, I have some time. How much? 5 minutes. Okay. So what is next at LHC? We have too many questions which are not answered. We have supersymmetry, we have extra dimensions, we don't know what the neutrino masses are, the dark matter is a well-established observation, how to explain it. At the Big Bang, I would have expected matter and antimatter in the equal amount. That's what my physics tells. Electrons and positrons, they behave similarly. The up quark or anti-up quark, they behave similarly. So what happened to the antimatter? What caused it? There was some sort of a discrepancy somewhere, asymmetry came up, that all the matter and antimatter annihilated. That's how the positron tomography works, right? So what happened to that particular symmetry? Why we have more matter now? Why there are three generation of fermions and we are not explaining the gravity yet? So there is a lot of stuff which is to be done. And for this part, again, Shomak should be able to explain you more. So in the near future, we are right now here in the LHC program. So here it shows the year wise. We started in 2010 and this shows what intensity we are running. And we are right now somewhere here. We have just finished data taking for this year. And there is a gap of 2 years and we will continue for 3 years. And then you see there is a sudden jump in the how powerful the LHC will be. It will run at 10 times much more power than now. That means it will generate 10 times more data also. So right now our accumulated data is going something like 500 petabytes. Now it will, we'll talk about in exabytes after a few years. Okay, and that's what makes this much more challenging. And the whole idea to increase is to increase the discovery potential at LHC, because you want to get the maximum out of it. But this is not so easy. Okay, so this is the accelerator, the chain again I'm showing. And to establish this, we have to update all these thick lines, the colored ones. And there is something like 1.2 kilometer region of accelerator region that has to be updated. And what you're talking about, these beam pipes, these are essentially the magnets holding the two. And the magnetic field has to be really, really consistent, otherwise you will lose your beam. So this is really technologically very, very challenging. So we are using the state of art, the radio frequency cavities. Right now, why we are not increasing the energy? There is always a question. If you want to sort of produce further massive particles, increase the energy of LHC. But there we are limited by the superconducting magnets. See, we have to cover the 27 kilometers. It's a huge, like we have something like 3000 magnets here. Okay, at the most we can go right now safely is 8.3 Tesla using the, I think it's niobium 10 device. To further increase it, we need a different technology, and that research is going on in parallel. So once we have a higher magnetic field established and scalable, we will be at a higher energy, or you have to increase the this path of the beam. So you go for a bigger ring. And there is a plan, there is a talk about 100 TV collider also using 100 kilometer ring in China, but that is still in the discussion. And the cryogenics, maintain all the magnets at 1.9K with superfluid equipment. So these are the two major challenges. But more luminosity, basically your collisions will be much more complicated now. So each Big Bang I was talking about, we saw some particles, the number of particles will increase 100 times in every collision. Then how do you do with your detectors? How do you deal with your detectors? How do you observe these? How do you make sense out of it? Can you find out there are two muons in this particular plot, in this picture? That becomes the issue. Okay, and secondly, the detectors have to be radiation hard. They will be facing much more radiation now. Now again, there are parallel things going on, like quantum computing, for example. It's a novel approach. If it works, it will be great. But it might not be at the time scale of like 5 years, or it might be like maybe 5 months, who knows. Okay, and Fermilab is heavily involved in this part also, which can really sort of revolutionize everything from biochemistry to code breaking. So the main target is for the quantum computing research right now from the high energy perspective is to boost the processing speeds as well as the storage capacities. What we are doing for the CMS upgrade, for the updating the CMS calorimeter, this is the detector piece, and I was talking about this one which will face the maximum radiation because the proton beams are colliding this way. So this is the beam pipe this way. Protons are facing. So when they pass through each other, maximum radiation come to this range, and that has to be updated. And for the first time in the history of energy physics or science in general, we are going for this super highly granular detectors using the silicon. Silicon is used in the center of the detector, but it's a small piece. To this level, we will be using something like 600 millimeter square of the silicon sensors. And that's the sort of testing and prototyping going on right now. And also, this part will be the scintillators, which is an established technology. And this will cover something like 60 million silicon channels in this small piece of the detector. Okay? So where do we stand in all this? And when I say research is going on, so this is like, for example, for this particular prototype, this small piece of it, we did some beam test at the CERN right now, just last month. And this is one of my students who was working there with the full team. So we really interact with the international collaborators and get the CERN facility for the beam test. But at the same time, we also try to have something at locally also for our developments, for training students, for developing the algorithms, for testing purpose and everything. And of course, the data analysis of whatever data we collect from anywhere. The other is the with this powerful detector, which will go in now, it will enable us to do sort of 3D imaging. So the idea would be you do the 2D clustering first, in a two-layer, two-dimensional, and then look at its three-dimensional picture, what exactly happened. So for example, this is a piece from a very high energetic gluon came in. It showed me something, but I can draw such circle anywhere in this picture. You won't get much out of it. But if you look at the three-dimensional picture of it, then you know what has happened. And there's a lot of R&D going on this part also, both from the detector design point of view and from the algorithm development. And all these algorithms we also want to make use of in the trigger level, right? Because that's where we are throwing away our events. And there, I mean, FPGAs are already being used, but the strength is being increased now. If you can have bigger FPGAs, we can have better algorithms directly implemented. So we talked about billions, billions, billions in terms of the atoms and collisions and all. Now coming to the collaboration, it's a collaboration of something like 4,005 members, 40 countries, and more than 200 institutes. And from Indian side, we at IISER are member of the CMS collaboration, and there are a few others. And most of them joined recently. Earlier it was only TIFR, BRC, Delhi University, Punjab University. And some of them have actually joined after IISER Pune came in picture. So we joined CMS collaboration in 2014. Okay. So to summarize, this is our universe again. And what we know is only the visible matter. We know about heavy elements, we know about neutrinos, we know about stars, we know about the free hydrogen and helium. Together it constitutes only 5%. Rest 95% we still don't know, which is the dark matter and dark energy. And that's why I said by the end of this talk I will convince you that we don't know anything yet. There is a lot to learn. Okay, so there are a lot of new challenges, but there are many things exciting happening because there has been a lot of developments in the neutrino sector, many detectors all across the world, and many new pictures coming out. Like we know, now we know that neutrinos have mass. So far our understanding was neutrinos were massless. They travel with the speed of light and they are massless. But now we know it's non-zero mass. But what is the mass, we don't know yet. And that's a lot of interesting studies going on. Even India is planning to have the neutrino observatory here, the INO you must have heard of. Then a lot of studies are also going on the gravity side. We have the gravitational wave discovered now. So more on the cosmological skills in gravity, I think you should attend Shamak's talk. He's a very experienced person and fantastic speaker. And he can really, really tell you all the details about what is going on in the field. And this is the bigger side of the spectrum of what we want to understand. And the relics of the Big Bang, like how it showed up in the cosmology studies. All these things will be discussed by Shamak Roy Chaudhary. And this is me here, just to tell you that, okay, fine, CMS detector is not a fantasy, it is there in reality. So this is, I think, from picture from last year. And this picture here shown is this piece of it, which partially we want to upgrade and replace in 7 years from now. So you can see the sheer scale of the detector. And this was 95 meters underground. We were not allowed at the 100 meter to go to the ground, because at that time I was as a visitor. So that's pretty much it. If you have any questions, thank you.